The European Patent Office podcasts bring you an insight into the technology and innovation shaping the world.
Hello, and welcome to this podcast from the European Patent Office, in which we'll be discussing, in one word, plastics. They are ubiquitous, from packaging to construction to consumer goods. Their versatility has driven forward material science for the best part of a century, but their popularity is now recognized as a growing environmental threat. So what's in store for the future of plastics technologies? My name is Jeremy Philpott. I work in communication at the European Patent Office, and I'm fascinated by technology trends. Our latest study on patents for tomorrow's plastics has some surprising findings. Joining me today are two of the study's co-authors. Both are from our offices in Munich, from amongst our core of over 4,000 patent examiners. First, we have Wibke Meiser, who has searched and examined patent applications in cable insulation and polymer manufacturing for over 7 years. Welcome, Wibke.
Hi, Jeremy. I'm happy to be here.
And also joining us is Maxime Dossin. He's an expert in plastic processing, especially the recovery of plastics, and has been searching and examining in this field for 6 years. Welcome, Maxime.
Hello, Jeremy. Hello, Wibke. It's a pleasure to be here.
Great. Well, thank you both for joining. I'd like to start by considering the scale of the problem. So maybe, Wibke, you can help explain a little bit about what the problems are in terms of recycling and where we're headed.
I will start maybe with telling you the numbers for the amount of plastics which are actually produced each year.
Okay.
2019, the global production of plastics reached a number of 370 million metric tons.
Oof.
Yeah, the numbers are quite high, and I think it's really abstract to make maybe an illustration of this. It equals the weight of 2/3 of the entire human population. And if you want a higher number, in the last 70 years, we produced more than 8 billion metric tons of plastics. And you are right in asking, you know, where do all these plastics end up? So 30% of the plastics are still in use, and 9% has been incinerated, but only 6% has been recycled. So you can imagine that more than half, so like 55% of all these plastics ever produced ended up in landfills or the natural environment.
Wow, 50% of all plastics ever. That's staggering.
Yeah, and the environment really means everywhere. So from mountaintops to deep oceans, you find them in Arctic snow, in our soils, there. And as you said, it's really a threat to the biodiversity, to all the ecosystems and our own health, actually. To make things worse, plastic production is forecast to more than double by 2050. And it will outpace the world's ability to collect the waste. So, you know, you can imagine like a giant pile of trash that just gets bigger and bigger. And I think we urgently need innovation to solve this problem.
Yeah, so it's a big problem. It's getting worse, and it's sort of running away from our ability to control it unless things change. And obviously, they need to change fairly urgently. Maxime, I know you wanted to say something also about the role of technology here.
Yeah, Wibke is right, but technology is only part of the solution. We also have to remember that legislators and governments are also working for the changes. And for instance, we have seen governments legislating against single-use plastics. But you know, when government says, okay, you must stop to use this article or single-use plastic, then we need alternatives. And that's where innovation and technology can help.
Yes, I think Maxime is right. I also agree that you can't reduce the plastic waste problem to a technological challenge. It's like more a systemic problem. So we really have to shift from this linear take, make, waste model towards a fully circular mindset, I would say.
A circular economy. Can you explain that a bit more?
Yeah, sure. So the circular economy is actually at the heart of the European Green Deal. And it rethinks the whole life cycle of plastics. So it asks the questions, how can we live well within the limits of our planet? How can we regenerate our ecosystems? And there are kind of three guiding principles. It's reduce, reuse, recycle. So reduce means that we have to reduce the amount of material we put into the production of plastics. We have to reduce the amount of greenhouse gases emissions during the production, and we also have to eliminate plastic waste. Reuse means that we have to design products or plastics that are reusable and repairable, because as you said, a lot of the global plastic production is only for single use. Mm. It's not for multiple use products.
Yeah, yeah.
And the recycling is about, you know, collecting all the waste and recycling it to make new products of it, out of it. But it's also about the better design of plastics. So how do we design plastics which can be recycled in a cheap process and with a low environmental impact?
This is certainly one of the things that I've been seeing in recent years, this move away from the plastics industry saying, oh, well, it's up to the consumer to recycle. No, the plastics industry itself has to be providing materials which are easy to recycle. Yeah, sure, the consumer has their role to play in making sure that the right plastics get put in the right bins, but the materials themselves have to be thought through properly and designed from the outset to make them easier for recycling. I'm curious to know, how are we measuring innovation in plastics technologies? Is this just a case of counting all the patent applications that we get?
No, we try to retrieve what we think are the most important inventions.
Uh-huh.
And we use one metric, which is the IPF, which stands for International Patent Families. And it corresponds to patents that are not only filed in one country, but in two or more countries. So we think that, or at least the inventor considers the value sufficient to seek protection internationally. By counting these IPFs, we have then a mean to quantify inventions by technological sectors, but also geographic origin.
Right. So the more important inventions, the ones that are worth counting, are the ones filed in multiple countries, right? So good. That's the IPF. But you also talked about geographical distribution. And can either of you give us some clues as to which countries seem to be in the lead?
Well, yes, that depends a little bit on the technology you are looking at. So we found, for example, that in the recycling technologies and for bioplastics, the US and Europe are the global leaders. So they have a share of 30% each of IPFs in these technologies in the period of 2010 till 19. And if you look at who's doing the research industry or universities, you have to split it up a little more. So for waste recovery and plastic to product recycling, which is often called also secondary recycling, most innovation comes from industrial research. But if you look at the chemical and biological methods, there fundamental research plays a much more significant role. So globally, nearly 20% of innovations in those fields originate from universities and public research organizations.
Whoa, 20%?
Yeah, and Europe and the US are especially active in upstream research. So they even have a share of 29% each.
Whoa, that's massive, because in the patent index, for all patenting activity to the EPO, we're recording about 5% of applications are coming in from universities. So if in recycling tech, universities are 20 to 29% of the share, that's massive.
Yeah, but the pity, I would say, is that you really see a difference between Europe and the US, because the US, they really are able to upscale these inventions. So they generate four times as many IPFs from startups and scale-ups than the European ones.
Oh, it's this perennial story of Europe is better at research and USA seems to be ahead in terms of the commercialization and entrepreneurship.
Yeah, yeah, I think Europe could do much better.
Okay, well, Europe, space for improvement. The study is talking about there are different types of recycling technologies. The sorts of things you typically see on news bulletins is sort of conveyor belts with shredded scraps of plastics, you know, being sorted and then dropped into some sort of drum or hopper where they're melted down and turned into pellets. But the study is saying that it's more than just that then. So what are the level of patenting activities that the study is finding then for recycling tech?
We tried to check the world technologies that are used for achieving a circular economy in plastics, which starts, as Wibke told before, from collecting the waste, then what you were explaining now, sorting, separating also plastics, optionally cleaning. And then we checked the mechanical recycling, which is basically the reuse of plastic waste for the manufacturing of new products, chemical recycling of plastic waste, where you are converting your waste in a mixture of basic chemicals or even monomers, which is the building block of the plastic, and also biological recycling, so degrading the plastic to compost or using living organisms or enzymes to also degrade the plastic waste to chemicals or even monomers. And finally, also incineration or recovery of energy from plastic.
Yeah, but one of the charts I was looking at seemed to suggest that patenting activity for mechanical methods of recycling has sort of been dropping off in the last few years. It had its peak 7 or 8 years ago, is now going quiet. And the boom area seems to be in chemical methods, what you described as reducing things down to monomer, for example. And the biological methods. So these seem to be the growth methods. Is there any reason why chemical methods should be more interesting?
Yes, the mechanical recycling is quite mature, as you said, but they are quite simple technologies and they don't allow you to process many plastic wastes. Maybe you have a reduced number of cycles which are possible. On the contrary, if you are working with chemicals coming from the plastic waste, then you can feed them, for instance, in the petrochemical industry or purifying it and using it to produce new plastics, for instance, which allow you to have more cycles
right.
from the plastic waste. So, and for the biological recycling, using living microorganisms or enzymes to have a recovery of the monomer and plastic waste is promising for fuel circularity.
Yes, I would like to add something to this point because the biological recycling with enzymes, for example, it's really promising, as Maxime said. However, it's only a small number of patents which really recycle to monomer. So most of the biological recycling is concerned with the biodegradation of plastics to soil, but it doesn't only lead to soil, it also generates greenhouse gases like CO2. And in some cases, worse, bioplastic, for example, ends up in the landfill, it can emit methane.
Yeah, okay. Methane, even worse greenhouse gas, although not as long lived, thank goodness, but even worse. Yeah, I think people forget that, you know, we talk about, bioplastics, you know, this sort of holy grail, this magical golden bullet that's going to solve our pollution problems. But yeah, depending on how the enzymes do their work, yeah, of course we are. We're looking at gases being emitted as the degradation goes on.
I fully agree. I think that there's this hope that bioplastics can just replace the conventional plastics and that would solve all our problems. But unfortunately, as you said, it's not that easy.
Yeah.
And I think there are like several common misunderstandings about bioplastics. Because first of all, they're not new. So modified cellulose is a bioplastic, for example, which has already been produced in the 19th century. Also, what we see in our study is that these types of bioplastics, so the oldest bioplastics, the chemically modified natural polymers, like chitin, starch, cellulose, they still generate the largest share of patenting activities in the field of bioplastics. What we see is that the number of innovations remained stable in the last decades.
Mm-hmm.
In some other fields of bioplastics, you see a growth. For example, the plastics from biosourced monomers, so where monomers are derived from plant-based materials, and then the monomers are taken to produce new plastics. This kind of bioplastics saw the fastest growing rates in the last 20 years.
Ah, okay. But if you're growing plants to make plastics, then that's plants that people aren't eating. So as some of the plants that they're talking about, like from edible crops or...
That's really the problem. So there's this competition, what you said, there's competition between growing crops for food production and growing them for plastic production. But there are some kinds of bioplastics which do not create this competition or this problem.
Ah, right. Okay, so not all bioplastics are necessarily from food crops.
There's one field of bioplastic production, which I would say is biotechnology. So where you use microorganisms like bacteria, and they eat, for example, food waste or methane or carbon dioxide, and then they produce plastics. So one of those plastics, it's polyhydroxyalkanoates, and they're really interesting because they are biocompatible, they have a high thermal resistance, so you can use them in medicine, packaging, textiles, agriculture. And the good thing about those plastics is you find the microorganisms which are able to break down these plastics to their original building blocks. You find those microorganisms in most soils and in most marine and freshwater environments. Because it's also the problem with many biodegradable plastics that they are only biodegradable under really specific conditions.
But also then, are you saying that there are even some enzymes there that can take as their input, as it were, carbon dioxide? And give you monomer or plastic as an output? Because if so, then that sounds like a really virtuous cycle, because you've got enzymes that are in some way facilitating carbon capture, and surely that's a good thing.
But the research there, it's really at the beginning.
Okay. Well, then I'm crossing my fingers for this dream enzyme that can do carbon capture and give us plastics all at the same time. Fantastic. I was looking at the last part of the report. It was talking about plastics with entirely new properties. There's some sort of mad combination of thermosets and thermoplastics. You know, you're both experts in this field. Can you tell me a little bit more about what the future of these new materials holds?
Yes, we can, as you said, talk about a new class of material. You said thermoplastic and thermoset. Maybe we can quickly explain what they are. Thermoplastic, you can easily shaping it by melting, typically the bottle, water bottle, and so on. And the thermoset is a material that are not recyclable and used for which are much more resistant than thermoplastic, and you can use it for higher added value application, like for instance aerospace or automobile or in the plane and so on. And these materials, which you refer to, they have some properties of the thermoset, which are the resistant part, and they are really hard and so strong material, but they are also repairable. You can't recycle them.
Ah, interesting. So how do they repair themselves?
For a thermoset, you have a strong interconnected cross-linking of everything, of every chains of polymer that you have inside. And this is not reversible. In this material, they made this bond reversible under certain conditions, which allows you to, as I said, to repair or to give a new form to your material.
That sounds great. Plastics that can self-repair. I'm never going to need any super glue again. Then just before we close, you're both examiners and effectively your job is to see the future, because you get to see the patent applications often long before a product hits the shelves. So as we're heading towards the close, I just ask, what are your hopes for the future of plastics?
There are a lot of incremental innovations, you know, which try to make the product a little bit better. And I hope that we really have kind of transformative innovations, you know, which redesign the complete product, not just a part of it.
Mm-hmm.
So think of menstruation cups, drinking water fountains in public spaces, or solid shampoo bars, you know, which really can reduce a lot the material input or the production of new plastics. And you also don't have to stop at the product design.
Right.
It's also about business models. You know, if you think of a car sharing, if one car is produced for 10 drivers instead of 10 cars for 10 drivers, you need much less materials.
You're waiting for the really disruptive game changer stuff to come. Yeah, so am I. Maxime?
I wish there would be more innovation in the collection of microplastics, for instance, which is a massive pollution. And it's not really something that is attracting the industry. And perhaps there is not enough policy pressure for that.
Yeah, you're right. I've been reading about the amount of microplastic that's now being found in the food chain. They're finding more microplastics in babies than they are in adults. It's scary, scary. So you're right. Policy pressure is often one of the things that drives technology as people have to respond to regulations. Thank you both. I'm afraid we're running out of time, so I've must draw our chat to a close. But it's been fascinating to get your insights on what tomorrow's plastics could be like. Our study can be found at epo.org/trends-plastics. Thanks to all of you out there for listening. Remember that the EPO publishes fresh podcasts every week on new technologies, studies into the economic impact of patents, as well as advice for innovators. So listen out for more podcasts soon. But for today, from Wibke, Maxime, and myself, it's goodbye.
Cheers.
Au revoir.
Goodbye, everyone. Bye-bye.
Subscribe to the European Patent Office's podcast channel, Talk Innovation, at epo.org or on your favorite podcast platform. Let's Talk Innovation.